what they found was that, that they only gained 10% of what was there. And they could demonstrate only 5%. And they applied none of the questions. Then they said, okay, let's demo in the training. I got just one of you to come up and, you know, demo it for you. And that turned out to be better. And they could actually demo the skill better. Okay, then they said, okay, let's do practice and give them feedback. And that increased their knowledge, increased their skill in terms of demonstrating it. Only 5% of them did anything with a question. And then the last one was they did coaching. Now, you know, some people think coaching is expensive, and I know some of you probably run into that, right? But how expensive is theory discussion? You don't get anything out of it, you can't do anything with it. How expensive is that? Pretty expensive, right? But see, what they were able to do in the classroom, and this is, I think, the two problems with coaching. One is that you want to make sure that you give them picks. Why do you serve a consequence? No, you need to see behavior that you want them to do. Now, the best way to do that is be on job with them when you see what they do. It's like a lot of things occur in an office. Well, what behavior can you change in an office? Only verbal behavior, right? Now, the second thing about coaching is that if you think about what would be the typical coaching process, I mean, how many hours a week would you spend with a given person? Give me some numbers. 5, would that be once a day? Would you do that much?
Yes.
All right, well, even if you did once a day, what are people going to do the other hours of the day? You know, if you look at, most people in the United States feel like it's a waste of time to try to solve the problem. So their environment's not set up to produce behavior outside. It's just like you can't do anything. Well, and part of the reason is that when they get out of jail, a large percentage of them will commit a crime the day they get out. And what have they done? Where do they go? Back to the environment that did what? Used to be in first place. And I'm trying to get our autism, I've done some work with autistic services on it. The model is wrong. We train people to be experts at changing autistic behavior, and they do some phenomenal work. But the problem is, they go home, and then the mother and daddy end up inadvertently reinforcing the same behavior that caused the problem in the first place. So what I say is, you as a coach or behavior analyst, train the parent to do that. If the parent doesn't have time to come, then say, well, we'll find somebody to do it. Because you want to shape the environment, and if you shape the environment in an office and then you send them back home where the environment's going to be shaped much more than you will be able to do, then you fight losing battle. And that's why a lot of people think it doesn't work. And it doesn't last because, you know, subject to all of the consequences that go on in your world. So think about that in terms of how you do it. See, it would be better if rather than teach a supervisor, to teach a supervisor's boss. They don't coach the supervisor's boss, and then you do some observing of what goes on, so you can say, well, I would do that. Soon after, here's what you did. Let me suggest another way. See if you do that. Because in fact, that's true. There are two things really that I think as a coach you need to know to improve what you do. Learn pinpoint be quick to put to bed. I worked up a little program for pre-vocational jobs. These were kids that had IQs of about 80, and they had rather menial jobs, like food service and working on cars, you know, washing cars, and that kind of thing. And so we got this guy. We had a master sergeant from the Army, and he was a mess sergeant. And I thought he was going to be a lot of trouble, but he was a good student, and he kind of applied. He brought this problem to me. He said, "Look, I've got this guy," he said, "and I read his report, and the psychiatrist says he's has an oppositional character." He said, "Everything you ask him to do, he does the opposite." He said, if you ask him to sit down, he'll stand up. If you tell him to stand up, he'll sit down. If you try to trick him, he'll figure it out. So he won't do a thing I'm asking him to do. Well, we had a token economy where they earn points to go to game room. And so I said to Mr. Brown, I said, "Well, look, when you go back," I said, "why don't you ask him to bring you his token card and give him enough points to spend an hour in the game?" He said, "I don't think I would not do that." And I was glad he said that, because he's thinking, you see, I won't reinforce the wrong behavior. I said, "No, think about what happened, what I'm suggesting you do." I said, "You say you won't do a thing you ask him to do. And what I'm telling you to do is ask him to bring you his token card. Is that something you want to do?" It took just over a week before he said, he told me later, the kid, the twin. Why would he not be? Because he had impaired the positive reinforcement with him when everybody else was on his case, because he would do it. So shaping is hard to do, because we're most of the time we start way above where the person is. But see, this is the problem I have with goal setting. Well, you set a goal where the probability of reaching the goal is 100%. And people say, "Well, that's too easy." Well, that's the point. Because it's not goal setting that changes behavior, it's the consequences of goal setting. So if they're successful, you know, then you can get them to do something else. I said, next time, say, "Get my calculator, and add up the number of points you got, and subtract the number you need to go to the game room, and so let me know, and we can go." So we changed the requirement, you know, over time. And very quickly he became, well, I can't believe I was going to say that negative, I mean, you know, he was cooperative and grand. You see, if there's somebody in your life that is reinforcing you, you want to please them. You want to follow their rules, whatever they are, you know what I mean? Within reason. You know, you want to follow them. So the first order of being a coach is you've got to establish yourself as a positive reinforcer. Why would anybody want to do what you tell them to do? I mean, you say, "Well, I've done this a lot." Well, it may work, it may not. It worked good, but it may not work. But the thing you want to do is to find in the first, your first session with it, find some thing that in fact you like, and pair yourself with some form of reinforcement. Benjamin Franklin said, he said, obedience is the child's first lesson, and let's see, the second, anything you will. Now, that sounds kind of harsh, and I know, but the idea is, what I think you meant by it, is what I'm telling you. That in fact, if you are somebody that people want to be around, want to be with, and see, easier for you to come back, that's only caused by positive reinforcement. So you have to think about, what can I do? What behaviors could I do? And, you know, the success of that. And so if you set a goal, it's up here, and the guy comes in right here, well, you don't like that. But you see, sit down here where he can do it. See, you know he can do this, and it works. So, pinpoint is critical on this point. So you say, well, exactly what can I get him to do? Exactly. And I say this over and over to people, and our consultants do it all the time, is what does that look like? If I would go out in the workplace, or I would go out in your house, what would I see the child do? If that gets out of the theoretical kind of thing and very practical, what do I want to do? Ted Yawn is one of my mentors. And, this is going to take more time because I just remember this. Ted Yawn is he was a guy who was a psychoanalytic trained guy, and he did this thing to prove that this didn't work. And of course, it turned out working. And he's a great guy because he's a guy that only has hard cases. In other words, they come to Ted when they're ringing up. And he was presenting at one of our conferences, and he was presenting a case of a young boy who I think he was 6 or 7 years old, and he slept every night in a parent's bedroom. He only had one child. He was probably picking it out. And so he's talking with them about what goes on. But he says this, and I love this. Now what would happen is that the parents would put him to bed, they would get in the bed. And I know if you have children or been one, you know this, right? You know, it's like you think you're asleep. But all of a sudden you realize there's somebody else in here named Burger. And you know, you open one eye. And by the way, the child almost always comes to the mother's side. Now see, I want you to think about why would the child most always go to the mother's side? And the answer is very simple, right? It's redundant. Because that's where the reinforcement is. I'm going to show you a formula and then so it goes to the mother's side. Well, what the mother does is she moves over and lets him. He finally goes to sleep. She punches daddy. Daddy gets up, picks him up, takes him to bed. And Ted asks him to count the number of times this happened a night. And it averaged 3 points something. And he said, not only is the kid not getting to sleep, the parents aren't either. So Ted says, let me come to your house and you show me what you do. And so he's there in the bedroom, you know, in the afternoon. And he makes the parents get in the bed, he's on, show me how to go, what you put in the bed, walk through it. And here's Wada. He said, man, tonight, keep on doing what you've been doing. How can everybody do that? Except make this one small change. He says, when it comes to your side of the bed, wiggle, but do not move. Now, he's got this much of the max, right? So what happened is, he tried to get in the bed, he'd fall out, he tried to get in the bed, he'd fall out. And mom wouldn't move, mom was asleep. Not the bell done. He goes around the other side, goes to daddy's side, right? Goes to daddy. Right. He's still not coming. Calls old daddy and gets in the room. So what Ted said is when he does that, and see, he can predict he's going to do this. But when he does that, I want you, both of you, to roll over on him. And he makes a very good point, which I think many parents never realize. He said, if you have 3 people in a 2-person bed, somebody's going to be uncomfortable. 7 years it wasn't. See, I'm thinking about when he did this, I'm thinking about giving him points and all this kind of stuff. He's already done that. Ted did that and somebody before that. They went to a psychiatrist that said he's got a problem with masculinity or something, you know, because he loves trucks. I don't know what he's. Hey, we decorated room. This is 40 years ago. It cost $10,000 to redecorate room. They had a plastic bed in the shape of a car. They had curtains to pack, you know. But guess, after spending $10,000 on the room, guess how many times he slept in it? No. That's depressing. So anyway, the secret to shaking is to start where you can, you got something believable. Now, I was having lunch with Ted not too long ago, and he was telling me about a couple that came down. The son had been suspended from school 3 times. And the school said, if this happens again, then we're going to tell him he can't do it. So they came to Ted. So Ted says he's sitting there talking to them, and at one point, he said, well, the father said, well, I can't be too hard on him because I was expelled from school myself. He said, I haven't done too bad. I'm on business. They went on a bit. Finally, the father went, we've got to make something happen here. And he said, okay, when do you want to see my son? Ted said, I don't need to see my son. Because he already knew enough about the environment to know that it's not the child's problem. So you've got to get that in your head that, see, if you look at one part of the environment, that is not the environment. And so let's look at, see, what else in there will be causing something to happen. Now, I'm going to get, this is a Pickett analysis. Actually, the book we're writing is on this Pickett, so maybe when it comes out, you won't buy it. But it's about the pigs and there. And how you design picks for the way you want. Because if you see, this is smoking. And if you see, you got all these big negatives like heart disease, lung disease, and all that from smoking. So why would somebody do that? Well, the reason they do it is right here, because all these picks. And if you look at them, look, we're talking about heart disease and lung disease up here, and then we're talking about good smell.
Yeah.
Well, see, basically what it shows is that the consequence of the future uncertain has been trumped by oneness of nature. So anytime you try to change somebody's behavior in a coaching session or with your spouse or your parents or your children or your team at work, what you want to begin with is, okay, how can I provide some positive meet certain consequences? That's the strongest of the consequences. This is, if you look at you see this. Picking a nick. A nick is as effective in stopping behavior as a pick is in general. Now, this is the learning curve. I'm going to show you this for one reason. That is, to understand that most learning starts slow and ends fast. And if you look in Leonard Alice's books and so on, there are thousands of these. I mean, in every conceivable thing you think of. Most of them started with a pigeon or a rat in the maze. But the fact of the matter is, the shape of this, humans do the same thing. Now, what this shows is, like, let's say we got a pigeon who's pecking for food. Well, initially, it's going around and not pecking very much until he finds that it will catch on this, he gets a pellet of food. And so then very rapidly accelerates to some acid. Now, when I hear people talk about it takes a long time to change, I mean, there are a lot of culture people used to talk about it takes 3 years to change culture. Well, the reason they do it is because they don't plan reinforcement, they don't plan frequency reinforcement. See, now remember, I said positive reinforcement accelerates the rate of response. So that means if you can look at the behavior and it's kind of creeping along, and which most companies have an incremental curve, right? We want to do 5% better this year than we did last year, 10%, 15%, 20%, whatever. But that's just a linear curve. understand that we're way behind. Don't give me any more. But it was good. Anyway, this, you'll see this kind of curve. What I'm saying to people these days is, look, if you plot your day, I was there. And you know I'm lying, don't you? I'm sorry. When you plot the data, if it's not increasing, get this, if it's not increasing, there's not enough reinforcement. I mean, it's just that diagnostic. People say, well, I'm reinforcing her, but she didn't change. Why are you not reinforcing her? When you reinforce her, you're going to see change. Now, you see that I talked about earlier, what, if you're in trouble, then I mean you accelerate the rate of really positive reinforcement to the point you get this kind of acceleration. Now, I can show you lots of examples. I mean, we've got you look at baseline and how to do, you know, this kind of thing. Let me show you this. Well, can you positive reinforce too much? And my response to that is, probably don't worry about it because you ain't going to even come close. Yes, here's the thing. If you do it wrong, one is too much, right? If you do it right, it's never going to be too much. I've kind of gone crazy over my golf in my old age. And I don't think I'll ever get tired of somebody saying good job. You know, no matter how old I am, you know, I hit the ball, somebody says, good shot. I said, I may be old, but I'm not blind. I can see the thing. I know it's a good shot. But I'll tell you this, my friends always reinforce the shot. I mean, even if it doesn't go the right way, they say, well, that was a bad lie out there. The right lie, that was a good shot. Put those people in the workplace, it's like God struck them down. It's like it hurts them to say good job. And I've had people, when I've made this point, I said, well, my problem is I don't see anything to reinforce. You see, I don't care where you work, there are more good things going on today than bad. Oh. And the problem is, and it's a big problem in business, is that we don't look at behavior. You want to manage by results, and with the results, you can't see the behavior, and you've seen in the paper, you know, oftentimes, the problem of that, that people lie, cheat, steal, get results, right? So you can't look at a result and tell somebody did it right or did it cheat. But if you see behavior, you can. You know that. Now, the point of this is that peers know who's cheating and who's not. This is a cartoon I have in my life, and it shows an executive looking guy standing in front of this guy at a desk, and he says, the executive says, why aren't you working? He says, I didn't see you coming. So the thing we're trying to do is to look at the behavior and see, is it where we want it to be? And that's going to tell us something about what our job got to be. Now, Marshall, if you let him, he'll talk to you about fluency and some other things. But I think that what we've discovered in the last few years is that there are ways to teach people. And I kind of went on a rant at ADI 2 weeks ago when we had a company meeting. We're still teaching people, I'm teaching you the same way, like the monks taught people in the 11th century. Like I'm standing before you, and if I were in a regular classroom, I would stand before you, and I would give you some assignment, you go, and you come back and I test you. When you're in a situation like that, if you've been in school, you have, right? Well, some of the technology, to the hospital now, it's not common everywhere, but it's some places are doing it. And let's say you have a big place on your hand here where you scraped it and it doesn't look good. They can swab your mouth, get your DNA, and print you a bandage. This is your skin. Figure that. They can print a kidney. Now, so far, they've only printed like mouse's kidneys, but they can treat urine. They can print a heart. I mean, all this stuff. I mean, when I'm talking about a printer, I'm talking about like a $500 printer. It's not something. A printer, a 3D printer today can print all its parts. They want to. Now, if you want to go into business on your own, a lot of you come and say, well, I'm on my own. Well, go into the 3D printer business. Selling 3D printers. You buy one, invest in one, and then you print some of your friends and so on, and sell them cheap, real cheap. Because they'll cost you that much to do. But anyway, I could talk a long time about technology. This here is a guy by the name of Walter Snyder, who's at the University of Pittsburgh. And years ago in the United States, Ronald Reagan fired all air controllers. Notice he said, if you strike, you don't have a job. And they struck. And probably the first time in the history of the United States government, they did what they did to them. So they fired them. Well, that's a big problem for air traffic, right? Some broke the picket line and so on, okay, but they had a lot of positions and nobody did. Now, to be an air controller, it's going to take like 2 years. This is what you see here is this line right here is a 3 year previous appearance. What Snyder did was train college students with no experience to be equal to or better than somebody with 3 years experience in 40 hours. And what this graph shows, this is the mean arrow, and it surprised me if I fly a lot. Well, the arrow was like 8 miles. The mean arrow was like 8 miles. You know, like they tell you to have a positive turn. And the turn is too late, too early, so you miss the airport at the same time. But anyway, what you see that they did is that by the third session, they were already close to the 3 year experience person. And after that, then all of it down below the line is they were doing better than the 3 year veterans. And out here, what he did was there was a 6 month battle right here. And they came back, had not done it at all, you know, during that period of time, they still were at the level of 3 year veterans. Now, that's fluency. And so this comes to the question of, can you do this too much? What Snyder said was the most valuable piece of equipment in the laboratory was a $10 computer chip that emitted a correct noise on the city. See, that's what I'm saying. See, now you see, if you're in an environment and you hear always beeping, it's probably driving crazy, right? Except what he had taught them, he taught them was that a beep was a good thing. And so when you hear beeps, it's motivational to you. Well, I'm not getting the beeps, so I may change what I'm doing something. Well, now how many positive reinforcers do you think is required to get people to learn this in 40 hours? You can't doubt that's not very well. 32 hours.
40 hours.
Well, if you think about it, kids who play computer games get more than that. They get between 100 and 200 minutes. So, you know, now remember, opera conditioning is when you operate on the environment to produce a result you like. So, you know, doing this, one of my grandsons is addicted to Minecraft. Anybody here know about Minecraft? baseball stadiums, built baseball, he built baseball stadiums and all this kind of stuff. I mean, really difficult things, it seemed to me. He built a cathedral one time. It was Rheims Cathedral. But you know, every time they do this and move it the right way, they can really do it really fast. I mean, really. They can add this and add that. And do it, you know. They lived in Chicago, and I was going to drive back my daughter and two children. And he's gnarly. He was about 8 years old at the time. And he gnarly is just a big pain in the rear, you know. He wants to stop. When we're going to stop, well, you know, I'm hungry. You know, I need to go to the bathroom. Well, but his mom bought him mine. Anyway, he got out of the car 11 hours later. Now, I didn't hear one peep out of it. I mean, he didn't even say to his sister, "Leave it off." I mean, but you think about the rain falls, he's in 1,000 hours. Now, see, how can you look around and get 1,000 hours? Now, this is. This is the most powerful formula all the way around. That's Mrs. What this explains, when I first learned about it, it's called the matching law. And if you, there are several books on it. But this is highly predictive. In other words, at one point, one of the professors did a study on it and showed that it was like 95% predictable. It would be a predictable thing to happen. But here's what this is. Now think about that walking through here. That a behavior or the rate of behavior is determined by K times R. Now K is the essence of it, the highest level of normal velocity. Right? Times the number of reinforcers for B. Divided by the same number plus something we call R sub E. Now, the way they do this is that R plus R sub E represents 100% of reinforcement. Now, we can divide somebody's behavior in being on task or off task. So, this is off task. Now, if your problem is to get more of B, there are only two ways to get it, right? Well, you could do good or bad. You could tell me, I'm sure. Let's just hold K constant. Let's just put K D one. You could increase R, right? If K is constant, you could increase R and, you know, get more. Or you do what? Decrease R sub D. Now, to put this in a more practical situation. This is what Kirk years ago. When they inspect the film, they have an infrared light because it's sensitive. And it runs by pretty fast. And so they were having quality problems, and this guy was supposed to catch quality problems because a crease in the film would show us a black line and not at all. And if you had oil on the photographic paper, it would have to have a dollar, black dot. And so they had a number of things they were supposed to catch. And what they would do is, it was actually mechanical in those days, because it would run by, and if you saw something, and you're watching, it's going by 50 feet a second or whatever, you would go hit a key, and it would actually physically cut, a little cut on the side of the paper. So when they started processing and packaging it, they would see the cut, and they were supposed to cut that out, so they would have, you know, good cut. Well, if you think about the person in there, like how much reinforcement is there to do it? Well, when there were lots of problems, it was easy. They caught most of them. And this is the irony. The more problems there are, the higher the percentage you catch. But you probably didn't think about this in terms of reinforcement. But anyway, there's a lot of them. You want when you got something to do, right? But now, we've improved the quality, so what you're doing is doing watch myself go by, you know, fast. Now, somebody comes in. They help me. Oh, hey, how you doing? Now, I turn my head, whatever. 50 feet go by, and as it works in the movies, there's a big black light right through all of these. Right? Because there was more reinforcement. You know, did you see that game last night? Yeah. Or see that movie or whatever, you know. And the time you spend there is taken away from this. So, what happens is that the matching law basically says that behavior approximates the reinforcement that you receive. In other words, the matching law says that behavior and reinforcement match each other. So if you want more, in other words, if somebody has a hard time concentrating, then basically that says there's not enough reinforcement on the task. You know, I've seen it all. You're working on a report, right? And I mean, how exciting is that? And so you're sitting there and you get stuck. And so what do? You say, well, you look out the window and you happen to see a bird on a tree close by, right? Probably a parakeet. Anyway, you see the bird and you might look at that bird for 2 minutes. You see the bird hopping about the tree and, you know, you want to develop it and all that. Because that's more reinforcing seeing a bird in the tree than struggling with the problem as it is. Now the answer is to increase the reinforcement toward this. If you look at these people outside, and I don't want to be critical of that, but just the observation that I went through. How many opportunities are there to talk about non-work stuff? They got to sit at the table. And they got all kinds of things that take up time, like, can you move that book over a little bit? I don't know, have enough room here. I mean, or, hey, I saw you talking to so-and-so. You know him? I mean, the opportunities are legend. So if there's not much reinforcement what you're doing, then you're in trouble. Now, the good thing about those times, we have them in the lab too, is that many people who are involved in that get a lot of reinforcement out of that. You know, so they can focus, and you know, you have to, hey, get them to talk, to respond to it. Because it's their project, and they want to make it, they've got something they have to do, and so they're dedicated, and so forth. So my point is, where we've got people who are too distracted, by other things, and we know how to correct the basis of that. We don't find ways to put more kicks, more positive, certain consequences in the problem, on the problem. Now, I don't have time to tell you all the details about that, but that's basically a lot of what we do in our company. We're working with, y'all call it buyer, we call it bear. You know what I'm talking about? They make aspirin. But we're working with them now, and we're working in 17 different countries, and I think more than 17 languages. I got a guy who is a missionary to New Guinea. Now, New Guinea, I don't know if you know what's like New Guinea, but that's where they have people with bones in their noses and stuff like that. Yeah, well, it's still that way. And he'd been there. He was actually 2 years old when he went there, and his parents were missionaries. And some of his tales he tells, he's written a book about his dad. But I mean, he's been shot several times. You know, by the way, that he's coming together or something. They have one crop. It's sweet potatoes. And the problem is, it's rainforest. So it rains too much, then rots the place to get what they want to do. All starving. And so a company come in to benefit. Their goal is to bring the benefit to the natives by making palm oil. what their jobs are. But what he told me was they have a terrible time with it. Because the company doesn't know how to work with them. And, you know, it's like if somebody told me that the fishing is good, then I'm going to leave and go fish. Because that's what I've always done. You know, I haven't just stayed in a building all day. And so he's bringing the people from the factory to Atlanta, first of next year, to learn how to shape the hay. And says what they're doing, they think they're making easy gold, but they're not. And he understands something about shaping. He's been to the strange of it. So he says, I'm going to get them so they'll understand this and how they can think about changing their processes in such a way that we can ease the requirements on them. You know, so they wouldn't fire somebody because they left in the middle of the shift. If in fact they've been doing, you know, they're doing better than they're through the eight, that's more than they have. But more detail about that than I can tell you. But the point is that it works with the natives in New Guinea. And this kind of thing works. See, what the folks are really important is what the natives are. And that's why kids are so hard today with traditional child rearing methods. You know, and tell them how much reinforcement they get. Well, these other things, you know, what you do and say to them pales by comparison. And so you got young boys that don't even hear you call them to dinner. I mean, is that hard or not? Because they just focus right on it. You have to, hey, 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 hey. Started making Toyota. We were working with automobile manufacturers. You know what they said? How much market share did they have? It was less than 1%. So what they do? Well, now they're worried about it, right? What's happening? Did you have it? Then you get that three times first. But in the beginning, when you double two, you don't get much, right? And when you double four, you don't get much. But when you double a million, you get much. And two, four, and so what we're trying to work with our customers to say is that you have to pay attention to this. What's this coming? See, we work with mine and a lot. And they work 600 feet underground mining soda ash. They got a machine that's 700 feet long. I mean, think about it. 700 feet long. And they have three people. Imagine. For 5 years, guess how many people they have? If you get a target from Arizona, Afghanistan, 30 years, whatever, you can manage somebody sitting in the feet. You can manage people. Robots are coming in. Heard about that. And I think he said in 15 years that robots will be indistinguishable from people. The movie's been made about that already, but you know that they can make skin. Assistance. And so anything is dangerous. I've tried to keep people safe. you've got a noxious chemical and you want somebody to go in and see, you don't put a person in the middle of the acid burn, you just send the robot. You know, if you don't climb a ladder, you don't climb a ladder anymore, you just send the robot. So what will that do to safety? Self-driving cars, you know, some self-driving cars will reduce accidents. They're here already. If you can do a self-driving car, can you do a self-driving truck? And every self-driving truck, I mean every company holding just in the United States, is begging for drivers. They're doing all kinds of things, increasing pay, increasing benefits, increasing time at home, all these sorts of things. They advertise on the radio, you know, 4 or 5 times a day. So I hear them. 10 years from now, they don't have a driver. So what they're going to do that is, what's going to say to you? You can think about your, you need to think about your business and that you interact with your coach. But what is this goal? What can I do to improve somebody's skills? Or, you know, it's like, I wanted to write a book one time called What for Parents, What to Do to the Silicon. You know, you can have a silicon, but you don't have a silicon all the time. So you got to figure out something to do in the meantime. And so I think we got an opportunity here because they have, the robots haven't taken over, but they're going to. If we're not prepared for it. You might have heard about this, but many people in, many American soldiers in Afghanistan are attached to a robot. And they have a robot that checks the landmines and that. They can hold this happen. And who wouldn't? If they save your life, who wouldn't? And they get as emotional about that as if it will, that some of them look like dogs. So the world, if you want to read about this, go to the web and look for Ray Kurzweil. He makes all kinds of things. And he tells the time. So I just say, this will be, and he's 90% right. He wants to argue about the other 80%, but 92% of that happened, and everybody agrees that the fact that it happened. So let me just stop and see. Time may be gone. Let me just see if you have any questions. I love talking about this, so I'm not going to have something to say. But it's only if you have questions. So let me see if you have any questions or comments about it. Is to put reinforcement into the work. And that's going to be more or less mechanical. In other words, you remember the Hawthorne study? It turns out he's fake today. But there's a book called Managing Bill by Stewart. And he discusses it a little bit. But the fact of the matter is that what he said there was every change increases. So what we do is build it in where you know how you're doing. I've got it right now. So far today. But I know I do this, and of course my friend Crook is in there, and one of the other employees is in there. So we see. So if we put reinforcement into work like that, where people just think about some way of letting a person know how they do it. So the more often we're able to know, then we've got the report. And we've got the ability to do this, and we may even have the ability to do more than that. And we know, by the way, the technology will tell us how much is enough and how much is too much. And we have a way to test that, you know. So that's pretty easy. We have the capability to use, but we don't. The other thing is, if you think about social will, which is what most people think about, what I tell people is think about, what does it take to have a friend? interest in them, right? It's not all about you, it's all about them. And you learn the kind of thing they like. I'm going to tell you this most of the time. If you know somebody really fortunate, you know them better than their spouse or their parents. Because you're going in wanting to know what you like, not say, well, you shouldn't like that. You know? And so I would say, just what we do is a lot of times in the beginning, we're just observing people. Now, there's a premat called premat principle, and I think you might want to read about that, because what premat does, and I've used this many times, is that if you have A or B, look at which one hurts the most. And that's the thing. You can do A or you can do B. Whatever you choose is a reinforcement for the other. If you choose B, then B is a reinforcement for A. I did this in a school one point where they were running a lift with it, and we taught the teachers to do this, you know, individually. Like one kid, for example, likes arithmetic. Nathan. So what you do is say, all right, when you finish this page of arithmetic, you do arithmetic. So use what you're doing. In other words, if you have time to look around, and as opposed to being focused on this, whatever you look at, if you concentrate on those, you just glance at it, you just you look at it, then that defines your reinforcement. Now, let me tell a word about patting people on the back. See, if I can watch you, is that a positive reinforcement? Yeah. It's not a positive reinforcement because what it assumes is you care what I think. See, and if I know, if you know that I will say one thing to your face and something else to somebody else, it's better. Is that going to impact you, baby? Is it possible? That's why I say you have to prepare yourself for reinforcement to start with. And your opinion will matter if you do. When your children, if you have young children, your opinion matters. And so when you say, I don't like that, you don't have to yell it. I don't like it. That's probably stop. Because you've established yourself as a positive reinforcement. Now, unfortunately, many parents do not establish themselves as a positive reinforcement to children. That's kind of like, you know, most people think about it. So, Yogi Berra, any of you know Yogi Berra? He was catcher for the New York Yankees. He always said all these things, you know, people make fun of. But he was asked at one point, he said, when he was manager for the Mets, said, Yogi, how's it, you know, you were a catcher and now you're a manager of the Mets. How'd that work? I said, well, I've observed a lot by watching. So that's what I tell you to do. If you think about feedback, just go out and see the kinds of things. Like talking to somebody may be a big deal. And I can talk about the interest and so on, let them determine the conversation. That may be really important. But you don't do that unless what? You can never go wrong reinforcing improvement. And see, those of you who can pinpoint improvement and reinforce improvement, don't get improved. You get it. So that's a lot of ways, but I think, don't think about money. We started out with money when I first started. We started out with money and merchandise and that sort of thing, and we quickly got away. Because if you don't do that for behavior, number one, you do that for results. And a result is typically going to be a PSP, positive future, and so on. And so what we want to do is focus on behavior and do that for the smallest change that we can see. Let me make just one comment. And it's a step to step, but let me say, well, embrace this, to child rearing, and I don't know your child rearing, but, you know, being a girl versus being a boy, the kinds of things that boys do versus men. You do things, you see all changes, I mean, you all like to make me believe it, so, you can see things, you see, with the children, she's like, well, it looks kind of peaky. I never was able to get her to pinpoint what peaky is, because I can't see it. And I said, you just, you know, I've got to act in 2 days, but they got to figure it out. And I think men have to work at it hard. To be where many women, I'm not really all, many women already are. See, but our experience in a plant or whatever it is, you say, well, how can we sell drug this? Women never ask that question. They already got it in their mind, I'm gonna make a cake, and you bake some cupcakes, and you bring some, and they organize it, you know. And we just stand around. We just have that conspiracy. That varies, but as a rule, I think it's true. I think you think that, you probably do. Yes, yeah.
So what's the basics of OBM?
Well, the basic element is the two things that is pinpointing and shaping. You can do those well, and you're gonna do probably 90%. Be 90% shaping. And that's this. Somebody, we were talking the other day. Monkeys have 99% of our genes. Same DNA. But that 1% really different. The 1% really makes difference. So it might be the other things you need to learn that will be critical. But I think the hell of it is if you can find a way to check and pinpoint. You have to be able to pinpoint and check well. You have to know where you're going to check. You know, kind of thing. But I think those things are necessary. I look back 40 years ago and what we got made was successful. In an environment where there's no reinforcement in the textile industry in the South. And so it turns out much everything we did worked. And I think today if we go back, it'd be much more sophisticated. But so I know you don't have to do it all to be good. But you constantly have to be looking for, okay, what the heck can I reinforce? And how can I do it? How can I do it more?
Well, it's perhaps a good moment to give a very practical demonstration.
All right.
Because if you want you to come back very specifically, please come back to Holland.
All
we
right.
need something.
Well,
we need a trigger. Something for someone that says, please come back. Well, I'm a trigger. But we thought, well, perhaps your wife can help us. Every woman likes very healthy vegetables, like chocolates.
Exactly.
You too.
Yeah, better.
Okay, then it's a double trigger. If you come back, you get another pizza for your wife.
Oh, no.
This one together, you know, everything is.
No, no, no.